I am Craig Anderson. I need to say that for the video camera. We're going to do a little laser light show after, too. So a lot of fun with that. My wife has a problem still talking to her people that she's with already. Her peers have a problem with trying to figure out what I do for a living. It takes about half an hour to explain it, and still doesn't make any sense when they're done. They just say that he hasn't outgrown the bug phase yet of kids. It's pretty much a pretty good explanation of it. What I'm here to do is to talk to you about how you're going to raise butterflies in your own home, how you can actually do this right in your backyard. Kids love to do it. It's a great experience. Good educational experience for kids to see this complete metamorphosis life cycle. I always tell kids that we don't have complete metamorphosis. We're like those other animals, like the grasshoppers and those sorts of things that have incomplete. We come out, we pop out like an egg, we're little miniature adults. We're not an adult sexually, so we're these little things that are non-sexual and someday keep growing and become sexual adults. Well, butterflies are a lot different. What the kids see, actually, is this egg that hatches into what looks like a snake, this caterpillar. A caterpillar, this amazing animal with 12 legs, it looks like, or more, or less, or whatever. Comes out, pretty soon it forms this dead-looking leaf-like thing, and it pops out like a flying butterfly bird-like thing. It's like a snake turning into an eagle for a lot of kids. It's an amazing thing to be able to show kids this. Talk about this as a biological, fun science thing. Not the easiest thing to always make fun, but I think it is. Anyway, what I'd like to do is I'm going to kind of jump around here, show you a few things, because I know that if I go too much over into your lunch time, I might get kicked right out of here. So, what I'll do too is I will be around throughout the whole day if you'd like to talk to me about some bug stuff. That's what I like. Well, that's what I like to talk about. So, what I'm going to do is show you a few slides to start out with. There's a few things I wanted to talk about, which is some important things to remember when you're raising butterflies. Everything has to stay very clean. Very important thing. It's very important to keep everything clean. Diseases are very common with these types of animals. That's why these adult butterflies are laying as many eggs as they are. Diseases, parasites, we have lots of problems with caterpillars, eggs, and adults. So it's a good idea to keep everything clean. Hot soapy water, make sure it's all clean and dry. Also, before you feed food plants, I've heard a 5% Clorox solution isn't bad. Dip the plant in and then make sure it's rinsed really well, though. Because caterpillars don't do well on bleach. I don't know what it is, but they just don't do well on bleach. This is one of my favorites, which is the Monarch, of course. I wanted to bring just the Monarch along to show you the some of the caterpillars. I've got a couple books, too, that I want to show you the outside of. The Golden Guide is great, but there's also a couple other... I'm going to just like look there. Oh, no, it's on the bleach. Where am I? Oh, thanks. Thank you. The Peterson First Guide to Caterpillars, I think, is great. It's got 125 caterpillars in it. Very simple, good little drawings, and I think it's one of the best ways to find out what you've got in your hand or what you've got on your bush. Start with Monarch Butterfly. We'll go to the next slide. And this guy is one of the giant silkworm moths. The Cecropia and the Polyphemus. Whenever I say that, people say, well, what are the common names? Cecropia and Polyphemus. Now, this one is Polyphemus, and it's kind of interesting. How do you tell the difference between a Luna caterpillar and a Polyphemus caterpillar? Well, this one, you can see right along here, these little yellow bands between the orange dots, and they go along the different segments here. That means it's Polyphemus. It has a nice, long, yellow stripe down the side, then it'll be a Luna. So this one is a Polyphemus. These are good ones to rear, I think. I think it's a good way to rear a lepidoptera. I think that start out with a moth just works well. This one, I'm going to move this a little bit so you can see the whole thing. That's life size. No, not really. You know, it's pretty darn close. This is a Cecropia. And you can see the colorations here. What are the little things sticking out for? Well, it's just to make it look like I'm orange and yellow, don't eat me, I taste bad, and you know, stay away, I'm poisonous. But actually, they're not bad. They're pretty good. This one is a Cecropia. It's a huge, huge caterpillar. Cecropia moth. The nice thing about these guys is they turn out to be the size of bratwursts. When they're this one was the size of a bratwurst about, and it was hanging on a willow tree at the Minnesota Zoo exhibit. And the willow tree, there's only one on the branch, and that willow tree was struggling. It was just holding on. It was just eating away. One thing about these moths, though, they do take a little bit more time. In general, the adults about in the spring. The moths, this species of moth does not have mouth parts that works as an adult. They come up just to reproduce, lay eggs, and die. There's nothing else that they're out there for, really. So they're very sensitive to pheromones, things like that, to find each other. In fact, at the exhibit, it was quite interesting. Once in a while, come out in the morning quite early, and when the moths were out inside the exhibit, it was quite common to see quite a large population of wild moths attracted to the outside of the exhibit. They'd actually come from the woods areas around this place, come right in, looking for those females. So, kind of interesting. The question is, what does it look like? Well, I always hear, well, what does it look like? It looks like a slug. That's true. It looks like a slug. I think it looks like bird droppings more than. And that's actually, in a lot of cases, what people feel this is supposed to look like. This is a very small tiger swallowtail caterpillar, or larva. This is the first few instars are this coloration. I think it looks like bird droppings. There's not many predators for bird droppings. So it's a good protection. After it gets a little bit bigger, you get a little different coloration. You get this bright green caterpillar, very easy to find if you're looking for them. Otherwise, you don't see them. Also, it's got a nice little yellow eye spot there to make it look like it's something larger, possibly a snake, whatever. It's a good way to, again, defend. The one thing I just want to point out, just so you have an idea, when you're looking at these caterpillars up close, you're trying to figure out what this whole life cycle is all about. You look down the sides of this caterpillar and you see all these legs. And we keep telling you that these are insects. No, people aren't lying to you. They really are insects, but it looks like they have just a ton of legs. A lot of these legs in the back part of the caterpillar are fakes. They're called prolegs. They're just like little suction cups, more or less used just to hold on to plant material. There's actually six legs up front on what will be the thorax that will be true legs, but the prolegs are fake. They'll disappear. This one is kind of interesting. This one is not very common here. In fact, I think there's only been, as far as I know, one reported incident of a zebra longwing butterfly in southeastern Minnesota. However, they do come up to Kansas. So occasionally, with a big wind, you might see these caterpillars, although their host plant is passion vine. Passion vine, again, is one of those plants up here that doesn't really make it through the winter. But it is available. I've seen it at Bachman's in certain places like that. This is an interesting one. It's got these little spines on the back. What for? Well, they just make it look a little more dangerous. Maybe it makes it look poisonous. Also, this one is known as poisonous caterpillar to would-be predators because it eats passion vine. Passion vine has cyanide. Cyanide doesn't taste very good. Cyanide is kind of bitter. It doesn't taste good. It'll also, usually with birds, it makes them vomit. And also birds die. By learning that these caterpillars, from vomiting a few times from eating these, they stop eating them. These are actually really interesting caterpillars, though. This is my favorite. These are actually cannibalistic. If there are too many caterpillars on that one host plant being the type of material that this caterpillar wants to eat, it will actually eat its brothers and sisters just to survive. Now, that's kind of a good thing, though, because if you think about it, you're looking at these monarchs and they're all eating side by side and having a good old time, and suddenly there's no food left. They're all gonna die. So what the VLC is a good way to defend its own continuation in this world. Another interesting part of this, too, is that these guys are very interesting genetically, I think, with what they do and who they are. When I say who they are, bug man's getting weird, he's thinking they're people, but the point is that these are very intelligent animals to certain degrees, or less, you know, we have to define intelligence, but the adult males of this species actually will go out and search for chrysalids, these little pupa hanging on the tree, that are female. Once it finds a female pupa, it will actually mate with that pupa, passes on its genetic code before it's actually an adult butterfly. The point is that these animals are very intelligent in that sense, where they do want to pass on their genetic code. That's what it's all about in biology. There is nothing else, just genetic code. This one's kind of interesting. Weird coloration, I think. This is a swallowtail. I think this is one of the black swallowtails. Usually this is kind of a greenish color, these yellow little stripes you see here. Most of the time they're going to be kind of a greenish coloration, but on this one it is a white color. This orange thing, does anybody run across one of those?
Yeah.
Yeah. I can still smell it on my hands. That stinks, big time. Good protection for me. What is it, just a little, I can't even think of the name right now for it. And?
Osmaterium.
Thank you. Osmaterium? And what it does is it stinks really bad. And what it does is it's a good way, again, not to get eaten. If something smells that bad, you're not going to eat it. Also, it just kind of prevents you from picking it up, even getting too close. It also is kind of a scare tactic. This little orange thing pops out of its head, and it's kind of weird. And you kind of wonder about it. So another nice way to protect it. So there is a chrysalid. Now, the chrysalids, you can see that, like, for example, I believe this one is a tiger swallowtail, or it is a swallowtail, but what I like about these guys is caterpillars have these little appendages that can actually produce silk. So you have something like the giant silkworm moths, like the Cecropia, or the Luna, or the Polyphemus, and they're producing this giant silken cocoon, just like silkworms do. These guys, the butterflies, do have it also. But what they do is, you can see right here, the connection to the plant is like a little girdle. And this is actually right side up. I don't have this upside down. It connects down here to the little twig and uses that girdle to wrap itself around and just kind of hangs out like that. And most of these are overwintering species, where what they'll do is pupate, or become this pupa, in the fall, late summer. It will actually sit through the whole Minnesota winter somewhere and pop out in the spring, right at the common time. Another interesting part about the pupa are these chrysalids. Again, in general, nothing's always guaranteed, but in general, butterflies have chrysalids, moths have cocoons. But as together, they're called pupa. Well, what this is a stage that looks like a dead stage or a resting stage. And actually, this is one of the most important stages of the most, when the most things are going on. This is where all the changes happen, where that snake turns into the eagle. This is right here. And what that cold snap can actually do for these animals is it actually is a diapause snap. Diapause is a resting stage. Well, again, it's not a resting stage. It's a very important stage of change. But we call it kind of a resting stage, so to speak. But what it does is this cold snap will actually make those certain changes happen. More or less, it's just a way of, I suppose, antifreeze, so to speak. Also, they're usually in the ground or close to leaf litter, usually protected in those sorts of ways against the nice dry winters, keeps them humid, lower down. What's interesting about this is you can look at it and all of a sudden you see wing pads. You see the thorax of the, or the abdomen of the butterfly. We had another view of this, you could actually see the separated tubes that will become its mouth parts, its long siphon and tongue. In fact, in some species, you can actually tell if they're male or female from the outside of this pupa. So, kind of interesting. Oh, the famous glue job by Craig Anderson, right up there. This is from one of our exhibits last summer, and this is a nice, healthy monarch chrysalis. And the way we attach them to twigs or put them up is to just do a little drop of hot glue. Let it cool for a second and stick it in there. Just a dab will do you. Fits right in. And eventually, it's kind of interesting with the monarch chrysalids. These are nice to work with because you know when they're going to pop, as I call it, or let's be more scientific and say when they emerge. The next slide, you'll see how this coloration changes. Suddenly, they become clear. You can see the orange and the black and the white spots, things like this, and you know that it's getting real close. Usually, it takes, I think, between 10, 14 days, something like that, from chrysalid to adult emerges with a monarch. Some species are different when you're just asking about butterflies that go over the winter. In general, if a butterfly is going to pupate late summer, early fall, they are probably the types that will overwinter, and some even actually overwinter as adults, et cetera. So there's lots of different ways, just depending on the species. But sometimes butterflies don't do very well. And that's again the reason why so many eggs are laid, so many caterpillars are running around eating things. What you see here is a good example of disease. You have everything from viruses to bacteria to flies. Once in a while, in fact, I have some with me today. I always carry pupa with me. It's kind of interesting. I have a Luna crystal or a Luna cocoon. If you shake it, it shakes back. And the reason for this is that a lot of these parasites that attack these fellas are types of wasps, known as ichneumonids, other types of flies, things like that. And when they lay their eggs, they actually insert. Since you're this Luna moth, you've got this cocoon, or this silken covering, and you're on the inside. You're protected, pretty much. But all of a sudden, that little wasp comes along, it's got this big, long ovipositor. So then if it sticks way in there and lay an egg inside of you, well, you can feel him on the outside, or her, I'm sorry, putting that ovipositor in there to lay an egg in you, and all of a sudden you start wiggling around, and you break your ovipositor off, and you don't get parasitized. So it's actually a defense mechanism for that animal. Works pretty well. I just wanted to show you this, where you see some of the butterflies emerging. This is from the lepidarium at the Como Park Conservatory that's under construction right now. It should be done by Mother's Day. We just use this hot glue to put it on a stick. You can see a nice little prick coming right out of there, relaxing. Come out with scrunched up wings, and boom. They just start pumping fluids into it. Starts just getting a little bit of extra air, a little sun, whatever it can get. And pretty soon you have a nice adult butterfly with nice. Thank you. I'm not sure. nice adult butterfly that could fly right away. A couple hours, maybe 6-7 hours, depends on the species. Some of the silk moths take quite a while. Yeah, that'd be great. I'm all done with the slides. So, after I've showed you the slides, what I wanted to talk about briefly were these two books. That's where I got lost in my beginning there. This is that first guide to the caterpillars. It's 125 caterpillars, and I think it's a nice little guide. Gives you a picture of an adult, also a picture of the caterpillar. So you got a nice picture of the larva and the adult. Nice way to go over. Also, this one, the field guide to the North American butterflies, the Audubon Society. It's got all, what's nice about it is you go to the back and you find your butterfly, the adult. You go to the back, tells you a little bit about each of these species. It also tells you what the host plants are for the caterpillars. It also tells you where you're going to find them, so you might not have found the right butterfly. It doesn't say Minnesota or Wisconsin or whatever, ever from you're from. And I'm going to keep rolling right along here. I guess what I was talking about before is that it's very important to keep everything very clean, like I said, when you're raising caterpillars, when you're raising these butterflies. Diseases, you want to stay away from these. If you start seeing problems with diseases, the best possible thing you can do for yourself and for the wild populations and for the butterfly is to destroy the larva or the adults or whatever you have. For example, with the Monarch program that we're doing where we raise these monarchs, we check for certain types of diseases, certain types of parasites, and if we find them even in our adults, we destroy those adults and then move on to fresh stock. It's just not good to propagate these animals in close conditions. In other words, I've seen hundreds of caterpillars on a stick with a little bit of host plant in the middle or whatever, and you're going to have diseases. All that frass, that's a polite entomology word for dung. All this frass in the bottom, there's a lot of worries about diseases. You're going to have a lot of problems with different types of bacteria, things like that. So it's very important to keep it clean. Fresh host plant is also very important. Also lots of air. Not too moist, not too dry. It's hard to keep it just right, but it's like watering a plant. You gotta keep it just right. If you have something that doesn't, let's say you use a big quart jar or a big gallon jar. When I'm going like this, it's a gallon jar. And you put it on that top, you don't have enough holes in it, you don't have enough air movement, it's gonna have some condensation, it's gonna get wet. Again, you're gonna have problems with parasites, you're gonna have problems with diseases. Best thing to do, use a little piece of nylon stocking, something like that on the top, and you find a piece of mesh. Different things like that will work out. And there's lots of different types of containers. You can use anything from something that I'm going to show you that's a handy little way to do the butterflies, rearing them on live host plant if you want. Was nice because Kathy blew through some of the host plants for you. A lot of the host plants are listed nicely in that package, but black swallowtails are an excellent one to start with and to raise because it is parsley and carrot family. So, for the host plant for the caterpillars, you just have carrots out in your yard, or you have these parsley plants, or dill, or whatever you have. I think even Queen Anne's lace works. Have those out there, you will get these caterpillars, you will have success with raising those type. Also, I mentioned Cecropia. Cecropia moths, Polyphemus, they're all good. These are the giant silkworm moths. Are we familiar with them? They're the ones that we see in Minnesota occasionally. The thing about it is that when the adults come out, they come out quickly, and they don't live very long. Since they don't have mouth parts to eat, they're going to come out, reproduce, they die in about a week or so. So it's got to be at the right time, you've got to watch for them, come to lights at night. When you do find them, this is what I recommend doing. This is kind of an expensive thing to do, but it's worth investing in a paper bag. Get a paper bag. I find it one of the easiest ways to get eggs off of a moth. You take a female, and a lot of these books will describe how to tell the difference. And it's really not that difficult once you take a nice close look, go to the library, pick up a book, whatever you want to do. You get this female, about 9 out of 10 females will have already reproduced by the time you see them. So 90% at least have reproduced with a male, so they will be fertilized eggs. Another thing too you can look for is you can look for tattered wings. The more tattered the wings, the longer the butterfly's been alive or the moth's been alive. That means that if it is a female, it's more likely that it's fertilized. But especially with the silkworm moths, you're almost guaranteed that they've already been fertilized. What you do is you take this handy dandy expensive bag, take that female and you place her inside, you keep it kind of open, you just fold over the top and put a couple paper clips on it. What you do is you leave her in here for like a day. What do moths like? They like the dark, they like to be kind of secluded. So this is the most, she loves it in here. She wants to stay in here, but you're not going to let her stay. What you're going to do is keep her in here for about a day, put a couple paper clips on if you want to.
After that, next evening, release her in the same spot. Let the caterpillar go. And you're going, now what? Well, you've got all these little eggs in here. More than likely, you're going to have eggs glued to the inside of this bag. So you rip open the bag, cut out a little piece of the paper around this egg, staple the egg to some of the host plant. I saw on the internet the other day, the question came across, what do we feed Cecropia caterpillars? And I think the question more should be, what don't they eat? It seems like they really eat a lot of host plants. Willows, cherries, birch. Look in the book and find out exactly what is the best one or what you have locally, but they are pretty easy to feed. And also, you saw those big guys on the pictures here. Caterpillars, I think, are even an easier thing to get a hold of and to raise. The larger the caterpillar, the less you're going to have to hassle with it. The monarch caterpillar, once it reaches that last instar, that last stage of this larval development, this caterpillar, it's going to form a pupa or a chrysalid pretty fast. It's going to become that chrysalid, and it's not going to be very long until you have that developed butterfly. So I recommend using the caterpillars, but again, I'm going to say this one more time just to be sure. Keep it very clean. Everything's got to be clean, fresh host plant. And what were the other things? Good air movement. Not too wet, not too dry. Those are the three main things that you have to remember. One of the questions that I've been posed a couple times is this really the right thing to do? Should we be raising caterpillars? Should we take these caterpillars, raise them in paper bags, feed them host plants that we cut for them, and then release them back into the wild? I really don't see a problem with it because I can't see a better way to educate people or to get an idea of how this works or what this is all about. However, they have to be respected, and I think that you just have to remember that this is a natural resource. I mean, these are very important animals, and sometimes we don't think of them as being a natural or an important animal, but these bugs are very important. The bug man speaketh. But they really are. They really are an important part. 95% of all the animals are bugs of some sort. So we do have to kind of appreciate them and take care of them. The one nice thing about the caterpillars, once you get them going, I would recommend that if you're doing Cecropia polyphemus and the other giant silkworm moths, I would stick with one or two caterpillars, and I would keep them separate. They're going to eat all summer. And like I said, you're going to have a bratwurst at the end of the year. And a handy way to do this, actually, I found, is to, here's my potted plant. Just pretend it's a potted plant with me, okay? There's the potted plant. Now, I always tell kids in the classes that I teach to go over and kick in a screen door so you can get a piece of screen, but you can buy this too. And actually, the fiberglass stuff is nicer. I was cutting this last night and almost needed some Band-Aids. But what's nice about this is you go to the floral shop, you get a dozen roses, and a dozen, two. Okay, you get two roses, and you put them in here, and they fold them up for you. You know, they put down the top. Do the same type of thing with this. All you have to do is wrap around the bottom, just a big rectangle piece. Go along the bottom like this, kind of keep the top open like that, kind of grasp it together. I'd recommend maybe using like a little piece of nylon sock or something like that around the bottom just to hold it together. And then once you get it like that, pull it and just pull it down a little bit. And then just put a couple paper clips on it, and that thing will actually stay there. In fact, the aluminum actually stays like that. But this is a good way to do it for just raising some caterpillars. You can also build cages if you want. I mean, you can go as in-depth as you want. I've seen people raise them in 5-gallon buckets. Just a 5-gallon bucket with a screen top. Have two of them, one's really clean, ready to go, new host plant, pull out the caterpillars, put them in the new one, clean out that one, just kind of a rotating type of thing. So that does work out pretty well that way. Also, you can, you know, like I said, with the silkworm moth net, you can also find pregnant female butterflies. That's also another way to do it. In the same type of cage, for example, if you had a black swallowtail, to keep the black swallowtail female alive, zinnias work very well. They like zinnias, easy plant to have in this type of pot and everything. But what we want to do is have some parsley in there so she will start laying eggs. So after you get her to start laying eggs, then you can go from that point. But like I say again, caterpillars are just as easy to find and actually a better way to do it. You're going through a lot of steps or you're saving a lot of steps. You haven't had to watch all these eggs. And out of these 10 eggs, you get 5 caterpillars. And those 5 caterpillars, you get 3 that live. And out of those 3, 1 pupates. I mean, pretty soon you're kind of losing it. Just gets smaller and smaller. So by starting with that big caterpillar, you're going to have a lot more success. Chrysalids are kind of hard to find. You really have to kind of know where to look, what to look for. If you have a nice big milkweed patch, it's true. Usually you can find monarch chrysalids, especially if you kind of walk out and start looking for other types of structure where after the monarch's eaten enough, it disappears, goes over and pupates somewhere else, on a tree, sticks inside something, whatever. So you can kind of look for those, but they're usually kind of difficult to find. So I usually stick with the caterpillars is what I recommend for raising these butterflies. Do you have any questions right now?
Do you think these cages outside in the normal weather conditions or in the house with their air conditioning?
That's a good question. I would keep them outside myself. I wouldn't, the one thing is that if you're gonna keep them inside, it's like a little project that you're doing with something, make sure that it's got good air movement into the jar and it's not like right in front of a window or something. Especially with a cover that's maybe a bit tight, because you're gonna get a lot of heat in there, it's gonna heat up, caterpillar's gonna die, it's gonna become diseased again. So by having this good air movement with a nylon sock or some kind of a screen mesh or something, it'll probably be okay. But I would just recommend having it outside somewhere. Porch, something like that. Also, when you get the silkworm moths in late fall, you've got these nice big cocoons. I'm not used to saying chrysalis and cocoons. You get these big guys. Instead of storing them in the refrigerator, because you have to get that cold spot, and if you have a frost-free refrigerator, it'll suck all the juice out of these cocoons. Because, you know, frost-free refrigerator is more or less a dehumidifier inside a cold thing. So I always try to find a frost-free fridge. And it's not an easy thing to find anymore. Those little mini ones are frost-free. But and I like to say frost-free, so I use that. Good question. Also, you can keep them in the garage. I've heard people digging clay pots, 3/4 in the dirt, and actually just storing them in there and covering it up with something too, just out in your garden. So anyway, it'll work. Do you have a question?
I have a water from Moose Egg Lore, painted ladies, and it's a little bit unrealistic because they've got the mush at the bottom. You guys are going to see your mush right now. But I experimented with that, or it also on so far, except with one hatch and put it all the way through the cycle to the moth. And that was so convenient because it stayed in the checkbook box the whole time. The leaf was there. Do you have any other recommendations of something that would work more naturally than painted lady? But it was difficult to get mulberry leaves in time before the school year ended here in Minnesota. This was a summer school class that I did, so we had access to the mulberry leaves that we needed before they stayed home. What would you recommend that we might do besides these two that we could accomplish in the classroom by June 6th?
It's a good question. The problem with by June 6th, for example, with the monarchs now that we're going to be producing for people, that they can watch the emergence from this pupa, a lot of these people will do it at the beginning of the school year in September, because the monarchs are here late August, September, right into that area, and they start moving back. So it's still okay at that point. It's a good question, though. What do you do this early in the spring in Minnesota or in a climate like this, because you don't really have that many flying around outside? There's a couple options. One of the options that I use a lot for the butterfly displays that I set up or for the gardens that I help people get going are some of the swallowtails, tigers, spice bush. These are available pretty readily. You can get them through like Carolina Biological sells them. I don't know if Insect Lore does. I don't think they do. But I know that Carolina does. Also, there's a gentleman named John Staples that has a company called Nature Discoveries out of Rochester, New York. And also Spineless Wonders in Minneapolis, Minnesota does some. What's nice about these is that these are the animals that you have in the refrigerator year round. So if you get a call from a school that wants to do a life cycle of the swallowtail or at least wants to study the emergence, you can give them one of these chrysalids in December and they can put it at room temp and it'll pop out early January. So of course you can't release it. That's one problem with it and all of that. So, but it just depends on what the class is looking for.
It was an interesting ethics question discussion in one of our fourth grade classrooms when something emerged from, I don't know, a cocoon or a chrysalid in one of the classrooms, and they knew it was too early to release the butterfly. And they were sort of talking about that experience.
Yeah, in fact, that's very true. In fact, the one that I like to use for classroom is the giant silkworm moth. Just because when it comes out, just this amazing giant lepidopteran, and it's just amazing coloration. And then you've got another story. I mean, you've got a story where they don't eat. Their mouth parts don't work. You know, so what do we feed it? Well, can't eat, so we don't feed it anything. You know, we just keep it, we miss it, keep it humid in the room and all that, or whatever it needs. And it's only gonna live for a week. So it's a pretty handy one for that type of, again, that comes back to the ethical question of wasting a resource. But then again, I think that educational point that you just got across is very important too. And by showing appreciation for those points, gets pretty, in the end it all works out and probably helps out the wild populations even more. Another question that you raised by the ethics is raising different species of butterfly or moth that are from other countries or from different parts of the country. For example, to bring in moths from India to Minnesota and to raise them is okay if you raise them in a building, but what prevents their escape? Once they get out into the real world or are outdoors here, are they going to take over certain plants? Are they going to destroy other types of, you know, living organisms? It's just like the little the problems that we see with zebra mussels or whatever. It's just an introduced species that can be difficult to get rid of in the end. So I think it's very important to stick with native butterflies, native plants in butterfly displays. And even in the great big ones now, you'll notice and you'll hear about Butterfly World in Florida. And all these places have these amazing butterflies from Europe, from Asia, from Africa, and all these different places. And that is okay. I think it's important to see those things. But I've seen kids and adults alike come walking in and seeing a tiger swallowtail. And I've seen bigger expressions of excitement on their face than seeing a birdwing butterfly from Malaysia. You know, so I mean, I don't think you need to always have those amazing tropical species. You can do the native species, and it's just as important. In fact, more important. Questions? Oh, come on. Okay, now, so you got to remember now. Important to keep it clean. You got to keep it not too wet, not too dry. And you're just sitting there going, I want lunch.
They
want the
butterfly emerges from the cocoon. Each species has a different type of butterfly that emerges from the cocoon.
Right. This is really kind of a cool story. Thanks. I walked right into this one. The adult butterfly comes flying along. It's going along, sitting down like this, coming down. Actually, the eyes are really cool on a butterfly because it's believed that, you know, they have compound eyes. They've got all these little lenses poked all over, so they can see back here and down here and over here and up there. And these right here are like bifocals, is what I've been told. So that this is some research that's been done. We're not sure, but it sure sounds good anyway. And they have these bifocal like eye facets right here, so they can see a lot closer and they have better vision of the plants and that. They can also taste with their feet and taste with other parts of their body. So they kind of go down and see this plant, and they just kind of touch it, and oh, it's right, so they lay an egg on it or whatever. So the point is that there are very specific host plants for specific species of butterflies. In other words, you can't raise monarch caterpillars on lettuce. You've got to raise them on milkweed. You can't raise black swallowtails, as far as I know. Of course, someone will point me out that I'm wrong. Black swallowtails can't be raised on milkweed, but they can be raised on parsley. Host plants are very specific. And when we talk about nectar plants, like the zinnia and the marigolds, and sunflowers, those are the plants where the adults feed. They go up for the nectar. They're the ones that the bees use, the ones that the butterflies use. And the host plants are, in general, non-flowering plants. Now, wait a minute. Let me rephrase that. They're not marigolds and things like that, but sometimes they are both. Butterfly bush is an example, or butterfly weed, things like that, where all of a sudden you have a nectar source and a host plant source together. So there is mixtures, and don't take it wrong, but the host plants and nectar sources I think are important to kind of keep apart too, so you know what you're planting and what you're doing. Question? Oh, see, now I have a bunch of questions.
This is kind of maybe off a little bit from what we've been talking about, but what do you know about the hummingbird moth?
Absolutely nothing. No, I'm kidding. Actually, I don't know a lot about them. There are so many interesting species, too. I mean, there are so many species, and I'm just kind of the wacky bug guy. So I go to places and help them, you know, set up exhibitry and things like that. And there are some really good systematicists and taxonomists and people that know about certain species. And there's a lot of good people that you can call. Even entomologists at the University of Minnesota, you'd be surprised if they'll actually return phone calls, things like that. And I think it's important to, more than I do, just about. To find the right people to ask those questions, also there's some great books out there. And some of it is kind of boring. I mean, I'm going to be honest with you. I've got one of my favorite books, my wife looks at and laughs at me. It's an ant book written by E.O. Wilson. It's this thick. And I mean, you look at it and it's pretty dry. You know, you're running through it kind of going, oh boy, ants. But there's little things in there that are really important, you know, I mean, or what you're looking for. So when I'm working with a certain species, I can go in there to the index and go, oh, just page 7 through 9, I can do that, you know. So just kind of look for that information, you should be able to find it. Question?
How do you give
in the water, do you miss them or?
Good question. For the caterpillars?
Mm-hmm.
The caterpillars, more or less, will get it from their fresh post-plant food source.
Mm-hmm.
Not too dry, not too wet. It's that same thing again. Where you want to maybe mist them, well, misting can be dangerous. It really is. You're asking for disease. I would say fresh host plant material, leave it at that. Just keep it fresh. That's the reason for it. It's got that right pressure. You know, the leaves are all nice and fresh, and they get in there, and it's got the proper amounts of liquid. Because that caterpillar is very specific to that species of plant. So it's probably the amount of liquid it does need. Adult butterflies are different. They get the nectar source, but they also do usually take some forms of liquids, but mostly minerals, like you saw the dung, the dead animals. They just pick up different things. Also, puddling is very important for them, for a community type of thing, but also for feeding and for minerals. It's a male thing. Males need the minerals, I guess. Go figure.
I'm waiting for you to talk about the Brillo pads.
The Brillo pads. Those aren't mine, but I'll talk about them.
Oh,
I'm sorry. Is that the Brillo pads, I believe. Whose Brillo pads are those, Tom? Can I talk about them a little bit?
That's going to be up in the afternoon. Go ahead, Jack.
Oh, okay.
We'll wait. Yeah, I don't want to blow anybody else's time. Question?
What exactly is a fresh host plant? Is that just a couple leaves over the top going in there, changing?
Fresh host plant would be, like, let's say you're using lilacs to feed a certain species of caterpillar. You go out and take a nice, fresh clipping. What I would do is use a small vial with a nice little plastic top or whatever, stick it in there to keep it wet. Maybe stick some cotton if the hole's kind of big so your caterpillar doesn't get in there and drown or whatever. So more or less what you're doing is you're just getting a fresh cutting. That's a fresh host plant. Just go ahead and do a nice fresh cutting of that material. And it should be, I've seen people say 2 times a day it should be changed. It depends on how many you're raising and how you're raising them. One nice thing is that if you use this potted plant, host plant, let them go nuts. You know, let them eat it. You can take off the top. No, you can take off the top though, because it is a caterpillar. They don't like run, away. So no, but seriously, you've got the time to take this off though, and get a good. That did sound pretty sarcastic, honestly. But, they're slow, and you can just take it off though in water. The thing about it is that's a good question though, because if we did have a black swallowtail adult in here, how do you water it? And one good trick is that butterflies almost always fly up. So if you're netting butterflies out there, usually like if you've got a butterfly in front of you, you go from the top. Or you can sweep them too, but usually you go from the top because they usually fly up. So in general, if you have this thing still on top, maybe lift it up a bit, the butterfly's going to stay up here or go that way. So
you can also put water plants by setting them in a container water.
Exactly.
It'll pull up. It's much easier.
That's the holes for, yeah. So you just pick it up. I didn't think about that either, thank you.
I don't.
Other questions?
Is there one variety of milkweed that's more attractive than another to monarchs, or are they just go to any of the varieties?
Boy, that's one of those tough questions. Anne, you have that question?
They use a variety of milkweed. I'm sure there is some variation, but mostly what I hear about discussed on variation of milkweed is the poison, the alkaloid that's in the milkweed, it varies among the species how much there is. So you can tell if you do a chemical analysis on the adult monarch what maybe it was eating. But just for my observations on milkweeds in the Midwest, just about anyone looks like it'll do fine.
Yep, I've had really good success with just about every type of milkweed that I've tried with monarchs. In other words, if it's there, they'll use it. If they don't have another thing to grab a hold of. Just the wild milkweed is good, also the butterfly bush or the butterfly weed, those sorts of things. I've had those just about eaten up in exhibits before because the monarchs are laying eggs on that and eating it up. Question?
I want to thank you for the wonderful experience and question that the bus did summer.
Thank you.
We're looking for a field trip again to experience this next session this summer. What's left of the bus exhibit?
Well, thanks for bringing that up. That's why I'm out on my own now. Actually, the bugs kind of took a turn. They are going to do the butterfly exhibit again. It'll be the same butterfly exhibit from my understanding. I'm not sure, but from my understanding, the butterfly exhibit will be there again. The bugs are gone. The bugs have been sent to other institutions there somewhere else. There are some interesting things happening with bugs, though. around this area. You're the butterfly with Hennepin Parks is going to be big. Also, you're going to have a Lepidoptera Society meeting here this year. Also, the Science Museum is going to be doing not backyard monsters, but the giant robotic insects. So there'll be a lot of classes. I'm doing some classes with them on some of the bug stuff. And so there will be more bug stuff eventually, and it's coming up. Also, the conservatory, I'm trying to push them a little bit, trying to get them to do some in Como Park. So there's some things coming along. Ken?
The beehive was donated to the Oliver Kelly Farm, and they're supposed to set that up this year. You may check with them to make sure that they're able to do that.
That's a good point. So you go out and see Ken's bees.
Yeah.
Ken helped us out a lot in the bug exhibit last year. Ken also works at the Minnesota Zoo.
The bees.
The bees.